And it's welcome to episode 22 of Shed Talks. I'm Jeremy Thomas. I'm the host and the founder of this fantastic podcast, and I want to welcome you. Episode 22 is actually a very interesting episode, and that is really because it could have been episode 1 of Shed Talks. If you go back in time, just before the lockdown, we recorded what is known as a pilot. And I think it was sort of for the BBC, really, Radio 4. And it was called Around the Kitchen Table. And it was going to be about, you know, people talking candidly, honestly, interestingly about their mental health stories. And it was, you know, pretty daring at the time. And I found somebody to be our guest on that, who was most interesting, had had a spectacular dodgy childhood, all sorts of awful things happened, ending up in lots of drugs and drink and ending up in prison. But then ending up, you know, working with George Michael and Fleetwood Mac and becoming a multimillionaire. But I want you to wait because I'm going to show you that episode in 2 minutes. The other interesting thing about this episode is that I don't ever talk about my own mental health in Shed Talks, but it's going to begin, when you get to it, with a little bit from me. And that's also talking to another sort of pilot, but you'll just have to wait and see. I think it'll be quite an interesting thing. So, are you ready? Are you steady? Here we go.
Many years ago, way before 9/11, I was travelling upstairs on a first-class flight to New York. I was a little anxious about money, so I decided to drop into the pilot's cabin. I introduced myself as Lord Thomas and explained to the slightly surprised-looking captain that as my business was doing incredibly well, it was likely there were going to be frequent trips between London and New York, so it seemed prudent to actually buy my own plane. "Are you sure you mean to buy a 747 plane?" For a split second, I thought he wasn't taking me seriously. But then he said, "Why don't you lease one instead? Far better value, and you can always upgrade whenever you want." Brilliant. Handing him my business card, I said, "Could you radio to your head office and get prices for me? I'll be waiting for them in the bar upstairs." All of this seemed entirely normal, reasonable, and common sense. After all, the purchase price of a second-hand plane would be around $20 million. The only slight problem was I was only 26 years old, had one maxing-out credit card and an overdraft of £7,000. Hey-ho, just another day of being on a roller coaster of high bipolar disorder, manic-depressive psychosis. My name is Jeremy Thomas. I write books and give talks. Alongside me is my old pal and major contributor to the A to Z Guide of Good Mental Health, the hugely experienced psychologist, Karen Cowan. Today, we are hearing from the man who gave the world Yo Sushi, Yo Tell, not forgetting Yo Home, a great public speaker, former dragon on TV's Dragon's Den, the highly inspirational Simon Woodroffe.
Always worrying when you're introduced with such a build-up as that, is it not?
Well, it's great. It's great that you're here. Really, very, really groovy. So we're going to be talking about mental health at this point. And you've gone on records, Simon, I think, as saying you're very proud of yourself looking backwards. And I think you meant that you're proud of yourself, not just for all the wonderful success and material things that you've achieved, but you as a person. And it's often fair to say, isn't it, that we don't understand everything going forwards, but we do when we have some hindsight. So can we start with...
Yeah, no, I think the power of hindsight is enormous. It's great. I'm in my 60s, and certainly I look back with some pride over some of the things I've done and also some embarrassment and shame. And actually listening to your introduction, I never went and tried to buy a 747, but certainly I... was big myself up. I mean, when I look back, I almost blush with embarrassment of some of the people I pretended to know, or the things that I said I'd done that actually had been done by other people. Amazing, really, the sort of facade. I was going to say that one puts on, but I should say that I put on through many years. And of course, occasionally it was quite useful, because you walk into a room and people believe you for a short period, your inner self.
Can I just take you back to your childhood and growing up in late teens time? What was that like?
Childhood growing up in late teens. I mean, I think the sort of big moments for me were, well, one was my dad was a military man, so we grew up around the world. And if you grow up in the military, and I think he had had a hard time growing up with his mum. So, you know, he had a hard time. He was a bit closed down, and my mother was fairly loving and emotional. But the big thing for me really was, you know, as a middle-class boy, going to boarding school at the age of 7. So the wicked, no, I mean, which when I look back, the thing is about when you're growing up is that it always seems to you, or it seemed to me, that it was a completely normal thing to do. But to leave my mother in tears behind and go off into what was a, you know, very difficult, you know, almost like a sort of prison, really, with not terribly nice people. And I had a very hard time there. I think some boys loved it, but I had a really hard time there. And I think that probably that with a bit of sort of home stuff set my course off in, is the wrong the right word, in a way that it took me a long, long time to work out and to relearn. I think that's really what I would say about all that.
What was your brother like? Did you get on well with him?
He was 2 years younger than me. And I think my brother Patrick always says, he says, well, you know, boarding school didn't do me any harm. Just, you know, I remember years later we told my mother about Mr. King, and she said, oh, we always thought he was a bit queer, you know, and he was extremely, so it gave us this kind of definitely a skewed vision of what sex was like, because we didn't talk about sex at all at home or anything like that, sex and love. And my brother always said it just gave me an unhealthy appetite in that department. But no, it was violent, actually. This character, who's now passed away, was a violent, aggressive, angry homosexual. And there are several in the school. And
he was the headmaster.
He was the headmaster. You know, right into it, you know, so my pangs and arrows of my childhood, I wet my bed. And I wet my bed for many, many years. And they gave me a rubber sheet. But they didn't ever change the sheets. So I slept in a wet bed for many years, and you know that must do something to you. And it was tough looking back. You know, look, I'm over it now, and I'm a happy person eventually. But I think that was the start that set it all up for me.
But I suppose that's the point, isn't it? That, you know, it's just that stuff. You don't, as you say, you don't know when you think it's all normal. And it's looking back like that, that's extraordinary, isn't it?
It gave me a sense. You know, you say you look back and you know yourself a bit. It gave me a sense of kind of quite low self-esteem and a hidden life, a hidden secret life, covered up by bravado. Brigadier Woodroffe from the Indian Cavalry Association, the bravado of, you know, we'll do better than anybody else, you know. And actually, for those of your listeners who are of a certain age, there was a comic in the 60s when I was growing up called The Beano, and one of the characters in it was called Lord Snooty, which became my nickname. And what I must have been like to be in a school like that and be called Lord Snooty. But certainly I put on a big, big front, which was nothing to do with, you know, the terrified little boy inside.
But as a terrified little boy inside, I think that often children make decisions about how they're going to survive. And do you remember making that decision after you left the school?
Yeah, no, I think that's exactly right. Yeah, you know, that's what I've worked out.
Is like this, like, how am I going to survive?
Yes.
Yeah.
And you know, you hear of kids who went through awful things, you know, much worse than this. But it's what decision you make. And I made the decisions I made the decision, I am not attractive sexually to women. You know, I made that very, very early on. I made the decision.
Why?
Well, I guess something must have happened at a dance in the holidays, or rejection or something.
Yeah.
And I made that decision. And that was deeply ingrained, you know, that I'm not attractive, you know. So what the result of that, and I don't think just to women, I think to people generally. So I felt that I had to work much, much harder, and I became really a show-off, you know. I still am to some extent to this day. I'm sitting here. And that I thought that in order to make friends, you had to be Mr. Big, be in all the teams, be the centre of attention, you know, be loud, all of those things. Mm. And it took me years to find out. I mean, that actually, if you want to have really good friends, shut the F up and listen and be interested in other people instead of constantly me. Mm. Embarrassing to say it.
But that whole thing that we all want to be liked, and some of us want to be really, really, really liked more. Because of that, I think that's fascinating.
But what about the fear?
And fear, you know, and again, you know, in a 50s family, fear, anger, all of that stuff wasn't talked about. And I was an angry kid. I remember at lunch one day. It's a rather formal, sort of 50s thing. I must be at 10 or something. My brother had this boy to stay who was very full of himself. And I picked up my plate of curry and threw it across the dining room table into his face. And I mean, they were just so shocked. You go to your room. But actually, in a modern family today, I think if that something happened, there'd be a conversation between the mother and father and say, what's Simon going through, you know?
Yeah.
And there was absolutely none. Because I was angry and I was fearful. But I think as I grew up and started to learn a bit more, and I had to go through therapy and all of that to do that, started to understand what I call how the world worked. And I think as a kid growing up, and I feel for a lot of our younger children, where you don't naturally learn that in a loving family, or even in a loving family and one that actually understands. Sometimes I hear people say how awful Big Brother is and how awful these TV programs are. But one thing they do is give us some sense, even Love Islander things, about how human beings work and what their emotions are and how we react to jealous situations or angry and all those things. And I actually welcome all of that, distasteful as it sometimes is.
Yeah.
But I had to relearn how the world works.
Yes.
And that took a long time. And I think now, they say that to be a great blues singer, you have to have suffered the blues. And I think that to actually be sitting and doing a programme like this, you have to have been through the mill yourself.
Yes.
And I think I went through that.
Okay. So just looking at a slightly tricky bit, and then we're going to get on to some of the nicer bits. But you had a problem with drugs and the police in your late teens.
No, I was busted when I was 18, I think, and I did 3 months at Her Majesty's pleasure. They made an example of a boy. I had some LSD and hash, and I sold it to a few friends. And I went to prison, and you know, actually, I was quite well trained because I've been at boarding school most of my life. I actually left school when I was 16, but I was quite well trained. But you know, it taught me one lesson, which was to never ever break the law ever. Mm. You know, to actually more than that, to try not to get yourself into situations that bring on really unnecessary stress.
Yes, but,
you know that's an awful moment when you think, oh my God, I wish I hadn't done that. You know, it can come right down to, oh my God, I wish I hadn't said that. But, you know, it's taken me a long time to learn not to get myself into those situations. But I certainly learned then never to ever break the law.
And you didn't have, that didn't leave you with any sort of shame. Conversely, hello, I know people who've been to prison who are very proud of it, you know, because I think it's...
I wouldn't say I'm proud of it, but no, I don't think it did leave me with any shame. Well, I think what it did do, though, it cemented. I was a rebel at school, you know, I got 2 O-levels, you know, I was always smoking behind the bike shed or drinking down the pub or, you know, anything to show off, really, to be the centre of attention.
So anyway, zooming on, what's interesting, you know, because then you worked in the music biz, stage designing and lighting designing, and that is pretty amazing, you know, and I know that was a very successful period.
I never really felt successful. Not until really quite recently. I always thought it was a roller coaster ride. I was trying to prove, I guess, as psychologists here would say, I can see your smiling face. I was trying to prove to my brother, to my father, to everybody around me that I was something and I was a big deal. And the harder I tried to prove it, the more separated I became and the less intimate I became with friendships.
Yeah.
You know, the only real close friendships I'd have with women, it took me a long time to really talk about things of my. So, you know, it isolated me really, that thing of trying to get success. I mean, it did actually lead me eventually to being successful because I had to go off and go and do that. So I actually don't regret anything like that.
But
I've had many friends along the way that I've dropped circles of friends and moved on to next ones and all of that.
Tell me. Interestingly, you know, working in the music biz, and I know what that's like.
Which you're done in, it. Of course.
Yeah. Did you, you know, working with, you know, I know you worked with Fleetwood Mac and George Michael, lots of other people who actually themselves had issues, mental health issues, certainly George Michael, I don't. That's
Did I relate on that level?
I mean, maybe you didn't. I mean, I just interested, you know.
No, I don't think I did because I wasn't kind of aware of anything like that. But I think what the big thing for me was that I'd been brought up, and I say a middle class, it was quite sort of, you know, we didn't have a great deal of money. So that was another driver to us, and a lot of our relations did. But it was sort of upper middle class. So I went from being in the British upper middle class of the 1950s to working as a roadie first on the road with these bands and being in the working class. You know, I was a worker bee in the thing. So I went to the thing. So I really did. And I cut all my ties with that world that I've been brought up with. Yeah. So I didn't know who I was in society. And then I went on from that. I mean, I got this great break, which was that I'd worked in a theatre and Rod Stewart wanted to do a big stage set. And I knew where to get the drapes and where to build the staging.
Ah, right.
So I became a stage designer. And suddenly I went from being the worker to being the middle class because I was a professional in the music business. And then I started to build some esteem again. But I went through a big social change. And all the while underneath it, this kind of mental low self-esteem, which formed itself at times as depression, but more so probably just anxiety, great anxiety, because if you live a kind of false life as a charade, you're always trying to cover up and you're always, you know, it's a pretty anxious way to live,
really,
I can
really,
tell you.
Really, really scary.
Yeah.
How do you think things might have been different if you'd have known, which you were, that you were always okay?
Well, I've often thought that because the thought I've always had is when I later look back at friends who we'd go to stay with and it would be a loving family around the kitchen table and they'd really want to hear about their kids and what they were doing and it was just really nice. That, and I always wanted that. So how do I think it would have been? I think if I'd had all of that, I wouldn't have gone out and be sitting here today for sure, either as a successful person.
Yes.
Or so actually, I have no regrets, you know, and I can make a great story about the rock and roll roller coaster ride of my life. It has been great. And I tell that story sometimes, but really it was a pretty lonely place at times and, you know, and it was painful as well. Mm. But do I regret it? Truthfully and selfishly, I'm enjoying my life at the moment. I don't regret a moment of it because I am who I am today.
I think it's quite interesting, if I mentioned, as I have a relation, actually, who was horrifically bullied at school, really, really badly, and he decided that to be safe, he needed to get really, really rich, and he became really, really rich. He still is. But he told me, but I'm still scared. But now he's dealing with the scaredness.
I've had moments of madness like that. I remember doing Dragon's Den, and suddenly I was meeting very rich people, you know, and thinking, I'm not good enough. You know, the same old, going way back. And, you know, then I had to really put a stop to it and say, actually, you've done well beyond your wildest dreams, not just in terms of money, but in terms of being able to express yourself like I am now, in terms of being creative and doing interesting things. As a parent as well, I'm very proud of bringing my daughter
Broken
up.
The cycle.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, because another, you know, you have these things that go on in your head. And the one I always remember is that the dysfunction or whatever you call it cascades down the generations unless you're able to stop it.
Which you have.
And my daughter wouldn't always say that I stopped it. But, you know, I stopped certain parts of it. It's such a leaking bin, isn't it? And stuff leaks out of it constantly.
Yeah.
None of us really know.
Yeah.
I think the interesting thing, as Karen's just said, that whole thing of when you work in something very, very groovy like music or whatever, and you've got your own problems, it's very easy that the business compensates.
Sure,
you know,
it is,
you are you are that person.
Well, getting the backstage passes and all of that
stuff. But also,
who you know and what they say.
But so much to do with life. The problem with the way we all live is people say, Simon, what do you do? I see. You know, so we're in the music business. It's very, very groovy. But when you stop being in the music business, that's the interesting thing. It's rather like your
question, what do you do, should be banned.
Yeah.
As asking about the job.
Without sounding like Alan Wicker
on
a bad day.
Sure.
I just want to check this. Because you came out, you got fed up with the music business. Or that's what I think happened.
I got fed up. I burnt a few bridges and felt I had to move on because I couldn't go back. You know, it's the truth.
Yeah, okay, well, that's great. Were you married? Had you got married by that point?
No, I got married. I left the music business. I was out in the wilderness for a couple of years, and I got together with a guy I knew from the music business, from the staging business, and we started buying rights to television shows, to recordings. It was before videos and recordings of live music shows, and selling them to television stations because we knew the managers of the groups, and I found out who the TV stations were by going to one of those television festivals. And so I was in a completely different world, and I got married while playing another part that I played, which I used to dress up in a suit, have slicked back hair, put a match stick in the end of a cigar and pretend to chew on it, because that's what I'd seen people do down at the Cannes television festival.
Wow.
Where I was there, and I got married to somebody I met while playing that part. And poor Claire, who's I love to this day, who's the mother of my daughter, she thought she was marrying this rather slick operator, which of course I wasn't at all. And that came apart fairly quickly. In fact, I think we were married for a year, actually.
Right.
And Charlotte was 1 year old, and we had a horrible divorce because, you know, I think she was probably playing a bit of a role as well at the time. So, you know,
We
both had lawyers to help us play our roles even stronger, and it all went terribly wrong. And, of course, you know,
but it's
come right since, which is nice.
But it was probably a big thing at the time.
I think, when
a marriage goes wrong, you know, it's like when your job goes wrong.
Yeah.
The terrible thing is when both go wrong at the same time. Yeah, was that big for you?
It was a very big moment for me because it metaphorically was the thing that really took me to my knees because it threatened my financial security and from that my emotional insecurity came out. And I remember... it was a big moment. I remember I had a friend who used to go to AA, to the 12-step thing.
Right.
He came round and I was just saying my awful divorce and I wish I could somewhere I could talk about it. And he said, well, you should go to one of our meetings. I said, well, I'm not an alcoholic. And he said, well, what's your problem? I said, well, I can't stop smoking cigarettes. He said, well, you should go to Nicotine Anonymous. And there was one in those days. There really was. And I remember going in. And I was late for this meeting, effectively it was, and I walked in and there was a woman there with tattoos all over talking about, she'd been a heroin addict and talking about how giving up cigarettes was harder. Mm. And that was a pretty good thing to hear for me. But what was better is that when she stopped talking, everybody shared back and they were talking about their lives. They weren't talking about drugs or alcohol or cigarettes. They were talking about their lives and what was going on. And it was the first time, and it was just such a relief. And eventually I carried on going to those things and eventually I actually stopped drinking and got into AA. But it was free for a kickoff, which at the time I had a great deal of money, which was very nice.
Yeah.
And secondly, it was a place that I, you know, call it indulgence if you like, but I needed it at that time where I could actually be truthful about who I really was.
Yeah.
And it was through those rooms that I learnt, as I said earlier, to relearn what I hadn't learned in childhood. You know, I didn't know I was angry. I remember reading a book called Healing the Shame That Binds You and thinking, wow, I don't even need to read that book. And that was a very, very big moment for me. And I've done lots of different courses and personal development things over the years. But that whole 12-step thing is the one thing that's taught me more than anything.
It's really
else.
Got you
being
going.
Accepted raw.
Yeah, it took a lot of courage.
Without the matchstick and the cigar.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah,
it took a lot of courage to actually be able to cough up and actually talk.
Yeah.
But once I did, you know, try and stop me.
Yeah, and everyone still.
Yeah, and
still
people listening.
Wanted you to be there.
Yeah, and interesting, exactly. Yeah.
But I think it's that point of desperation, isn't it? You know where.
Yeah.
And presumably, you know, one doesn't want to have to bang on about how awful something was. But I think it's really important, for me anyway, that when we have somebody like you, who I greatly admire, you know, that people can go, blimey, that is Simon Woodroffe. He felt like this.
Yeah, sure.
You know, and I think, you know, because I think that's the point, isn't it? You know, that lots of people who suffer from depression, low self-esteem, but, you know, all of those, that little package go, this is just me. I'm the only one in the world. Who
Very much so. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly how I felt. A lot of shame about it. And you're right, you know, for listeners who have been going through a hard time or whose kids are going through a hard time, they don't know what the hell to do. We're very, very lucky. We live in a world where there's an awful lot out there, an awful lot out there that you don't have to pay for it, especially the 12-step thing. But, you know, if you've got some money, there's lots of other things to do as well. And if your parents are sitting around going, what shall I do? You can look it up on the internet, and there's a lot of people who'd like to take your money off you, and it's
absolutely.
An awful lot of money.
Absolutely right.
And actually, in the end, the place you probably end up is in one of the AA 12-step thing. There's lots of different ones now, but somewhere in there, because they are effectively support groups that happened all over the world.
We live in a time where there are not that many instant solutions around.
Where do you get help?
And
actually, I think really the thing is that while you are compos mentis, as soon as you have some sense of I've got a problem, I want to get some help, then you can start doing it. It's when you've thinking it's not my fault, it's everybody else's fault and all of that, that it's hard to get started.
Yeah.
Same for parents.
I suppose it's helping your children to have some sort of self-knowledge about, as Simon said, I need to phone
someone.
I'd
say it's that simple. And those self-help groups, there's an enormous amount that gets done.
I think so. And I mean, it's probably a bit controversial, but I wouldn't advise anyone with a serious mental health problem to spend a lot of money on it. Yes. Group therapy.
Learning from your peers.
Yeah,
and
learning.
From people who've been through something. You know, whatever, however bad it is your kids have got in, if they're smoking dope or whatever it is, the great thing is that there's lots and lots of people who've been there before. And when I have a problem with the law in business or with accountancy, you go and find good people. Thing about finding good people in business is they always want to charge you a lot of money.
Yeah,
so you've got to look for the good ones and the bad ones, and you've got to be a good client yourself.
Yeah.
And it's the same with mental health. There's always, there's people who've been there before. Find somebody, ask their advice, but listen. And it's very easy to think you know better, but just listen is the thing.
Well, what I think helps, actually, sorry, I'm just going to interrupt here. What I think helps, you know, is to hear. I mean, I really like to hear, not just being gratuitous, your lowest point at around this time. What was the lowest point, and you know, when did you see the light? I mean, I know you've talked about meetings and everything like
that. Well, there are lots of low points. I remember for all my bravado, you know, it looked to the outside world like I had a fabulous social life, masses of friends, you know, big career, all of that. And I remember being really down and depressed and sitting in my little West London flat and thinking to myself, there is nobody. And it was, you know, there probably were people I could have done, but it felt to me as if there was nobody that I could call up and just say, I'm feeling shit. You know, nobody except my mum.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to do that to my mum. And there were probably people who cared, but that's what it felt like. And it's amazing, isn't it, that when you really are feeling down and you're under your duvet or whatever, the world is a completely different place.
Totally
you see it
different.
Through this mask of thing.
And
to
yourself.
To go out to somebody who's living, and yourself, exactly. And to go out to somebody and sort of say that, it's very difficult. To walk into a room where there's other people who've been through that, who are willing to listen to you, that's a very different matter.
Yeah.
Then you are accepted. And from that point, you can build yourself up again. So just going to talk about things with your friends doesn't work as well as going to talk to strangers who've been through what you've been through. And that is a very, very powerful thing.
I think it's true, isn't it, that, you know, when you are really, really seriously depressed and in it, that you can think, well, this is it. You know, this is, I'm not depressed at all. You know, this is just me and I'm crap and this will never change and all of that stuff. And, you know, that's where it's so important not to stay isolated and to believe, you know, as well, I think what you're saying, that you can actually, there is light at the end of the tunnel.
And also to try to separate yourself from it and to say, this is depression.
That's where the information and knowledge and stuff like hearing Simon today makes such a big difference, because you can go, oh, I see, he felt like that. That's how I feel. Gosh, you know, I mean, I'm not being prescriptive. Just think, why should you know if you're 18 or 28? Why should you know?
Well, it's a long track, and they call it recovery, and it's a very good and descriptive word because it is a long-term recovery. And Freud and Jung, I believe, he says not being terribly well read in the matter, said that everybody should have some kind of therapy, in inverted commas, whatever that is, at the age of 21, wants to correct the misnomers that they've built up during their childhood. And again, when you're 40 or 50, to correct what's happened. And that is kind of what happened to me. And it took a long time. And basically, my own recovery, I mean, I had some great Jungian therapists. I learned to interpret my dreams. I've met there were various people who were good influences on me along the way. But really, I did it myself. And I think that's the same for all of us. And I learned from little bits along the way. It's a funny thing, you know, things that people said, you know, idea of letting go, you know, that you get up every morning and on my left shoulder, I'm highly serious about my life. And on my right shoulder, an equal measure, it really doesn't matter. I'm not very important. So, you know, to try and just go out and do the very best you can, but to let go of the outcome, that is such a simple idea.
Yes.
But it took me years to really get what that meant to me in my life.
I suppose it's also that thing of self-awareness and honesty, isn't it? That, you know, because you can think to yourself, well, I'm very honest. That person asked the time, I told them the time. Yeah. That means I'm honest. But that
even more so in my case, which was, you know, I thought that honesty was blurting out all your inner thoughts about everything. And it's not. It's about being quite considered and, you know, being able to share with people about things appropriately, not being over-honest. I think I was over-honest to people, scared them all off. I think that, you know, the idea of, you know, if you weren't feeling very good, there are several things you can do. I mean, one thing, if you're not feeling very good, is get rid of the thing that's making you not feel good. If you know, if that's an outside influence, which often these things are. Another is to go and do something, you know, whether it's do something for somebody else or take some exercise or this, that, or the other. And then the third one, which we hear more and more about these days, is all the mindfulness stuff about meditation and yoga and all of that. But I think also just the idea, I've got one that I use at the moment, I'm happy to share it with you, which I call Stop It. But, you know, in my mind, I can make up stuff. I'm, you know, I've a propensity to be anxious about things, but I can make up things that are almost bat certain never to happen. You know, my mind invents them all. And then what happens is I get worried about it.
Yeah.
So I have this thing that I just say, Stop It. So as I get older, I think less, and I hopefully less goes on in my mind, and it's a bit sort of stiller, but I just, if I have one of those worries that comes up, I just say, stop it. And I can say that several times in a minute. Mm. And actually it works. You stop it and you don't worry. And after a while it passes. So I think there are ways of talking to yourself.
There's a funny bit of research about generalised anxiety disorder that 80% of worries of somebody with generalised anxiety disorder have either a positive or neutral outcome. And 20% have a negative outcome, 85 and 15. But that out of the negative ones, 80% of people were perfectly able to cope with even the negative outcomes. So if you've got extreme anxiety... What's the big deal? A, you're worrying about the thing happening, and B, you're worrying that if it went wrong, you wouldn't be able to cope. And there's actually research that shows the likelihood of it going wrong is much slimmer than you think, and B, you'll be able to cope.
So true.
So with you, Simon, basically... You came out of this period, and did that emerge straight into Yo Sushi, or was there a crossover? I mean...
No, Yo Sushi came at a point, you know, in my life. I had other ups and downs. And I ran around Hyde Park, which is 5 miles, and I'd never run more than a mile in my life. And I got to the end of this, and I was actually just sweating profusely. And I think I did probably sob, and I thought, my God, I cannot believe I did that. And I thought, if I can do that, I can do anything. Mm-hmm. And that was the moment that I thought, I'm going to go out and start a business. And I started researching different businesses, and Yo Sushi came out of that. But it gave me the motivation and the wherewithal. Because I think one of the things that I hadn't realised is that I thought that people who went and did very difficult things, like start a business that becomes well-known or something like that, were special people.
Yes.
And they weren't ordinary people.
Yeah.
And actually, they often are ordinary people, and they're often ordinary people just like me.
Yes.
Who had a bit of a chip on their shoulder. If you're a bit angry, that can be quite useful. I always say a bit of, you know, a grit in the oyster. Perhaps we didn't have so much growing up, or I felt a bit less than.
Yeah.
So it's quite good to have those things, because it drives you to go and get things done. And once I got the bit in my tooth, I was sitting in a restaurant on the West End of London with a guy from the TV business, and he said what you should do is a conveyor belt sushi bar in a world where nobody ever heard of conveyor belt sushi bars. And I remember going out and researching it and just getting completely obsessed with it, and then actually getting a brochure in Japanese first, sort of showed me there are lots of these in Japan, nobody'd done it over there, and thinking to myself, my God, I hope nobody's seen this.
It's your mind in business translating
this into the present. Yeah. It's your mind that makes up this thing, oh, it'll all go wrong, it'll live.
Yeah.
And I remember I used some of this stuff, actually. I used a thing, I said, you know, I'd say, in order to delude that negative side of me that says it's all going to go wrong, I'm going to act as if. So I would act as if I am somebody who's going to go and start this great big chain of restaurants.
Yeah.
And 3 months later, interesting time, 3 months, because it's nearly 100 days. And if you just chip off 1% improvement today, at the end of 3 months, you've got 100% movement. That negative voice in my head was gone. And I start waking up in the morning, and I've got this new voice that's waking me up. It's going, you're going to be very, very rich and very, very famous and very, very successful.
Yeah.
Fortunately, you know, I've been around long enough in this old world to know that that voice is just as big a delusion as this one. But it gets you out of bed in the morning, and it got me going, and that's how Yo Sushi started.
And that's amazing. So it would be true, wouldn't it, to say that probably without some of those mental health problems, you wouldn't have got to that point.
No, very definitely. I mean, to have a chip on your shoulder, to have a grit in the oyster, to be feel angry about things, to want to change things, to want to make other people wrong and think that you know better than everybody else, you know, unattractive as it may be and not very good for friendship sometimes, it actually does mean that you can go off and get things. And I'm sure if you analysed all the great generals or, you know, people who've done really, really difficult things, you know.
Yes.
But although I must say, more I see great leaders, certainly at an older age, the more I see people, for the most part, who are good listeners and good human beings, but perhaps have not always been that way, but have learnt to be as they get older.
So. But would you say also that it seems to me these days that a lot of people overprotect children, overprotect siblings, so to prevent them from failing in any way? Do you not think that having some failing at certain things in your life can be a real strength? If you've failed, you can get on. I mean, Richard Branson failed at various things, and look at him.
Sure. So no, there's it's a very, very complex world, and there's the opposite to everything. You know, they always wheel me out every year when the A-level results come out to say, you know, here's somebody who got no A-levels and did very well, so don't worry too much. And I always say the same thing, basically, which is in this day and age, if you don't go to university, you go to the university of life, you could be very advantageous. You come out 3 years later with 30 or 40 grand better off than your compatriots with three years more experience. And I think, you know, really the what's happened in the last 50 years is just the tip of the iceberg about what we're going to see. All really about education. If you really want to get rid of the difficulties we have with prisons, with dysfunctional people coming out out of very difficult childhoods, rational decision to turn to a life of crime, to get rid of it, it must go back to education. And I think educationalists are thinking that more and more. I heard something the other day, that Dominic Cummings trying to get rid of A-levels, and I sort of agree with him in all of that, because you know, I left school at 16 and I never had the imagination educated out of me. And I think to actually create really rounded people, that's what I wish for people coming out, who can be get excited and enthusiastic and passionate about things, is every bit as important as academic education. Although, you know, I hope that if you're going to be a brain surgeon or indeed a psychologist or psychiatrist, I hope you've had a good academic education.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So if we, before we get on to the last part of this, you know, I'm always aware of the person who's listening, you know, who's crashed. You know, whether they've crashed mental health wise or they've just crashed in their life, you know, where you just go, it's all over. You know, the wife's left. I'm living in a bedsit and, you know,
top myself
and whatever.
Yeah.
So, you know, I always think I just want to bear that one and bear this bit in mind that, you know, this old Scottish doctor, Dr. McTavish, in 1868, when asked, what do you need to be happy? He said three things: something to do, someone to love, and something to hope for. And I think those are pretty good things, But I'm interested, Simon, in what you think, you know, just your, what you would say to someone sitting in that lonely bed, you know, having everything's gone wrong, or someone who's just in the pits of depression thinking it'll never get better.
I didn't know that was Dr. McTavish. I've used that one myself. In fact, my daughter always uses that one. I think it's a very, very good sort of trio. Something to do, you know, there's always something to do. I was on an island in the South Pacific once when I was sailing, and I met somebody whose kids smoked dope and they couldn't, I don't know what to do, there's nothing to do. And I said, there's loads of rubbish in the street outside. Take a plastic bag at 7 o'clock every morning and for 2 hours pick up the rubbish. Right. And when people ask you what you're doing, you say, I'm helping to clean up the neighbourhood. I bet you anything you like that somebody's going to say, you're the sort of guy I need. Are you going to help me?
Yeah. Great.
You know, it's just making those moves to do anything. Step outside the front door. Stop thinking about what you're going to do because you'll never work it out. Go and do anything regardless.
Go and do something.
Be willing to fail as well.
You know? And it doesn't necessarily have to have a point, because when you're very depressed, you think, but there's no point in doing that. So you just don't do anything. So it could be just mending a broken ashtray.
Doing something
anything.
Simple, exactly. Doing and step outside your comfort zone. You know, if you're comfortable just sitting there smoking, don't step outside your comfort zone. We're all brought up to think that if you're feeling uncomfortable, you should quickly get back inside your comfort zone. Actually, feeling uncomfortable for a reasonable period of time is a very good way to be. You know, my sort of vision was, you know, if you drop a pebble into the water, you see the ripples go out, and your comfort zone gets bigger and bigger the more you step outside.
Yeah.
So step outside, feel uncomfortable, feel the fear and do it anyway,
yes,
or whatever that
yeah.
one
yeah,
is
yeah.
called. So that's the first part of that. Somebody to love, well, I'd leave that till a bit later on. Give out love to people, stop looking for love and give it out.
And you can love it. You can love a pet. You can love a dog.
You can love anybody, but exactly. But you can just love being generous to other people. One of the great tricks I learnt, if you're in some cool party or you're out doing this or that or the other, don't look to hang out with the cool kids. Go and look for the person who looks like they're lonely or on their
own.
It's an amazing thing that you when you do that. Because for a kickoff, everybody notices and they all come round you. I mean, it's a really thing.
Yeah.
Go and find somebody else who's feeling out of their depth and give them your full and undivided attention, even if they're boring as hell.
I think that's
and
great.
That's a really good thing. And then something to look forward to. I just look around. I'm driven by ideas. I love to look at anything and say, how could I do that better?
Yeah.
And the one thing I look for when I'm looking for people is enthusiasm. And if you can get enthusiastic about things, and you know, I have an idea, honestly, a minute or two after having the idea, I can call somebody up and say, I've got this new idea that I've started working and doing the research on it. I've only done the research for a minute.
In your head.
In my head.
Yeah.
And people take you seriously.
Yes.
And have lots of things on the go. Get a notebook, start writing down everything that you could do or you could do, and just do some random ones, and then just make some random phone calls. I remember at my very lowest, phoning up the rock music promoter, Harvey Goldsmith, who I'd always been very scared of in an early age. And somebody said, challenge yourself to do something that you're really scared of doing it. And I didn't think he'd even answer my call. He said, Simon, he said, I haven't seen you for a long time. It was very, very nice.
You never know.
And suddenly that opened a door into a new pasture. Thank you very much, Harvey, if you're out there.
Yeah.
I think there's something to hope for. I mean, you can say, well, I've lost everything, I haven't got anything. And I think, in other words, you just have to refocus and find something to hope for, don't you think? Anyway, but on that note, what I want to know is, what are your go-to things that keep you on the level?
Well, what comes to mind? I never met the person who went out to do what they really dreamed of and regretted it, regardless of whether they later succeeded or failed. But I met many people who didn't have the courage to stand up. So I'm one for standing up and trying new things out all the time. I do. I've climbed since I was introduced to it as a boy when I was at school when I was 14. I'm a climber. And I'm a sailor as well. I like to sail.
Where do you climb? What do you do?
Well, I've climbed all over the world. I'm a mountaineer, and mountaineering encompasses a lot of different things. It's rock climbing is my thing these days, warm weather rock climbing. And it's a gymnastic sport. You know, it's aerobic. But I've always loved the mountains, and there's nature. And there's a really good thing in climbing. If you're on a really difficult climb and you're only just balanced, you're just staying on, you know you've got the rope safety there, but you're just staying on and you've got a really difficult move to make, and the fear's up, your palm is sweating, and you reach up. Climbers have a word, but often you reach what they call a thank God hold. That's true of life as well.
That's
but, you know, if you keep going long enough, you always get to a thank God hold.
Yes.
Yeah, that's great.
I like happy things.
Yeah.
I don't like scary movies. I don't like unhappy endings. It's probably because it was a bit too close to the truth for me. But I love anything that's uplifting, and I admit to liking ABBA, going to see Mamma Mia multiple times, and definitely loving the sound of music, the musical.
Well, that's quite a lot different to mine, but I like The Long Good Friday, but that's a very old film that nobody will have heard of as well. Manual tasks are very important. Any thoughts?
Yeah, I love to use my hands. I've got a sailboat which I look after when I'm on it, and I'm forever repairing something. The great thing about using a screwdriver or electricity meter or whatever is that it's not manual work at all, it's brain work. So yeah, anything that uses your brain and you do things for other people, definitely.
Yeah, okay. And do we listen to the radio? Do we go on the internet ever? Do we, you know, anything from that sort of point of view?
My question always to people is, when you go on the internet, what do you go to?
Right.
You know, that's a good clue as to what you're interested in. I'll go to sailboats, or I'll go to motor cars, or self-improvement things, or travel. Big one for me.
But you wouldn't be listening to any podcasts.
I'm a big fan of them. I don't listen to enough. I've got one called Yo-How. Instead of know-how, it's yo-how.
Oh,
what do you
good.
Think?
That is really good, yeah.
Well, that is absolutely fantastic. I want to say thank you very, very much for being here, both of you. It's been Trez Groovy. You are Trez Groovy, and may your groovometers always stay at 8.5 to 9. That's
thank
it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rory.
Thank you.
Fab. Thanks a lot.
Wow, well, that was Episode 22, and that was Simon Woodroffe, who really did not disappoint in any way at all. He told it how it is, he told it how it was, and even he told us how it's going to be as well. And actually, if anything, I would tell you to listen to that again, because he always makes lots of laughs, but underneath it, he's, you know, giving out a lot of good stuff. And soon we will have on Shed Talks Simon's life jacket, how he stays afloat. And we will also have the marvellous Karen Cowan, our fantastic psychologist, commenting as well. I would like to thank our long-term editor, Luke Tupman, for being a groovy person and staying on the case with us. And also our new illustrious editor, Claudia Edinburgh. And thanks very much to Whistledown Productions for being there when it counted. Please spread the word about the benefits of intergalactic mental health travel and the benefits of becoming a shed head. Thanks for listening. Bye.